Good morning.
Good morning, Chris.
We are here today at the GCC Pavilion at the Qatar National Convention Center, which is one of the sites that is hosting the COP18 conference on climate change. I'm here today with Khalid Aboulaif, who's part of the Saudi delegation and who acts as a special advisor to the Ministry of Petroleum and Mineral Resources and who's the chief negotiator on climate agreements. We're going to be speaking of economical diversification and the importance of economical diversification in a country like Qatar, for instance, although most of the revenues are generated by the oil and gas sector, and the gas sector in particular. The country has embarked on a very aggressive diversification process, whether that is finance, education or health. So I'd like to ask you a very simple question. If you could share with us the numerous initiatives undertaken by the government of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to further diversify its economy, and perhaps a word on where do alternative and renewable energies fit into the picture.
Well, Chris, economic diversification is a strategic decision that the Kingdom took many decades ago. And that direction has many causes to it. Basically, one cause is Saudi Arabia would like to hedge their future into possible changes in their economies in the future world. A second possibility is that we wanted to provide those opportunities at for our young generation to grow in a sustainable manner within their beloved countries. As you all know, Saudi Arabia has been blessed with an abundant hydrocarbon reserves. That is, for us, we look at these reserves as we are custodian of those reserves. We do have two challenges. One challenge is that we wanted to make sure that we are fueling the world with energy and the supply of energy. And that energy is so important for the economy. A second challenge is that we need to do all these operations in a manner where we really take into account environmental concerns as well as sustainable development measures to make sure that we are moving and managing this resource in the most sustainable manner. So these challenges, as a matter of fact, come head to head with the work that we do within the convention. So under the convention, as you all know, policies and measures that are taken under this convention has great implication on the oil industry and the oil sector. And those implications, as a matter of fact, has been identified and has been studied and assessed by many international organizations such that are really credible in this field, such as the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and other credible institutions in North America and in Europe, and they all agreed that the countries that will be most impacted by any policies and measures that takes place are going to be oil exporters, and developing countries oil exporters. With that, as a matter of fact, the IPCC has quantified some of those impacts. One of the conclusions of the IPCC says that the revenues could be reduced by 25% by 2030. Another conclusion is that the GDP will be impacted by almost 13%, which are great impacts that a country would have to face, even though they don't have direct responsibility from a historical point of view into the problem that is caused by global warming. And this is why we have worked with the international community to make sure that this is a special circumstance for the region to be recognized. As a matter of fact, it has been recognized under the convention in a very famous article called Article 4.8, and it was recognized also in the Kyoto Protocol in an important article called Article 2.3 and Article 340. And under these articles, we have taken so many measures that are addressing this question from the international level. Even though we are not satisfied, we still hope that we can do more under these articles. And however, these measures are there available for us to work with, and we are working with our partners to develop them in a manner that would ensure that our economies will not be impacted as much. We're not waiting to see whether the world is going to impact us or not. We're, as a matter of fact, taking serious measures to raise the resilience that we have in our economy and to make sure that any measures in the future that would take place and would impact us would be taken care of by these policy measures. So Saudi Arabia has already moved in the direction of economic diversification. We have taken major efforts, as a matter of fact, in this area. Technology, so we saw as the most important direction that we need to invest in and work on. We have worked so much in the R&D, and the R&D, as a matter of fact, in so many areas that is related to making sure that our oil is done in a manner that will be sustainable and green in the future. Now, in addition to the R&D efforts, we have done a lot of work in the area of renewable energy. We have done also a lot of plans in the area of energy efficiency. Mm-hmm. And as a matter of fact, we have even embarked on a very advanced and really courageous project in the area of carbon capture and storage, or carbon capture use and storage. And this is enhanced oil recovery. And this project, as a matter of fact, is sponsored by Saudi Aramco. And Saudi Aramco is going to hopefully introduce this project and work on it, and hopefully put it online by the year 2015. And hopefully we will find out of this project many questions that we have in the area of climate change, so that we could bring the carbon capture and storage and enhance oil recovery more closer to for commercialization, which is an extremely important thing. Now the kingdom is also taking other national efforts in this area. Carbon management, for example, we had already agreed on a carbon management roadmap. That carbon management roadmap has 5 focus areas, and basically most of those focus areas look at win-win opportunity, whereby we make sure that oil is green, as well as it also help us in the economic diversification process that we are embarking on. Carbon capture is one important part, and this is for stationary industries. And then the innovative one, as a matter of fact, Chris, is the mobile sector capture. And as a matter of fact, many investments are being done. If you go to the exhibition, you will find out that one of the products of this program is the car that we have there to reduce the emission, mm-hmm. to capture the emission from its fleet. And that program is, as a matter of fact, under development, further development. We have also worked with, in a partnership in government, public-private work with Saudi Aramco, and we could say that there are many centers that Saudi Aramco has undertaken in these different focus areas. For example, we have a center in Detroit that the company is sponsoring, so that they advance the idea of carbon capture. Also, a third area is carbon use and carbon applications. We think that by making value out of carbon, then we really are going to improve the sustainability of the use of our hydrocarbons. And that value, as a matter of fact, could be done through projects that could convert the CO2 into fertilizers, or convert them into useful products that humans could use in the future. And this is one of the focus areas we have. And then finally, we have a fifth focus area on carbon capture storage, the saline aquifers. And there is a lot of work that is done in the kingdom in this area, so that we advance also carbon capture and storage in particular, net use in those areas. So as you can see, so we are investing so much in those areas. We are embarking ourselves on an economic diversification program. That program is moving. At the same time, that program has so many co-benefits. Mm-hmm. The most important co-benefit to it is mitigation, because there is a lot of reductions that we're going to do while we are embarking on that program. Another co-benefit is many adaptation projects that are taken, that will be taken to enhance sinks and to enhance the resilience of our coasts and mangroves and coral reefs, so that we make sure that adaptation is fully undertaken under economic diversification, because we see both of them. Mitigation and adaptation are two faces of one coin. The more you do in one, the less you can do in that. So I think without doing both of them, I don't think we're going to have great success in advancing our economic diversification program.
Thank you very much for sharing your views on this.
Thank you.
Thank you.